Thanks for wearing red. I mean, wow. I feel like it takes me back to my alma mater, and I just feel like we're in this gymnasium at Conemaugh Township, and we just all need to yell, "Go Indians," because we have our red on today. But the real reason we have our red on today is in honor of heart health. February is National Heart Health Month, and so we decided that we would celebrate life this month, honoring heart health. And today actually is Women Heart Health Day. This month, we're starting a series called Be Mine, and we're looking at the condition of our hearts. And so each week, we're going to talk about a different type of heart. Today, I get the healthy heart. And we're going to end the month talking about a broken heart. And that service, though, is going to be a time of remembering our loved ones that we have lost. Because let's face it, if you've lost a loved one, your heart is broken. And although your heart is beating, it never truly beats the same when you lose a loved one. So we want to set aside a Sunday to honor that as well, because that is a very special time. And a verse kind of, it's on the front of your bulletin that the team we had talked about is, it might be one for you to memorize this month. It's taken out of Proverbs 27, verse 19, and it says, "It is your own face that you see reflected in the water, and it is your own self that you see in your heart." And I want us this whole month to just really examine our hearts and what's going on inside. You know, you can't always see what's going inside, and we can cover up how we're really feeling. But to think about it, it's your own face that you see reflected in the water, and it's your own self that you see in your heart. In other words, what comes out of your mouth is a sign of what is in your heart. So what is the heart? Well, if I was going to say medically speaking, the heart is this muscular organ, and it pumps this life-giving blood through our bodies, and man, it provides oxygen and nutrients and all of that good stuff, and when it's functioning well, we probably don't even really know, right? But if it's not functioning well, it's an organ that we rely on for survival. And when our arteries get clogged or when things aren't functioning properly, it can be very dangerous, and it can even lead to possibly death. So I think it's safe to say that the human heart is probably the most vital organ that we have in our human bodies, because it's what keeps us alive. And so the fact that everyone is here today, you are alive, you are living and breathing, so your heart is functioning. And God has placed a heart in each one of our bodies. So we need to take care of our heart, right? Physically, we need to take care of our heart. We need to make sure we're exercising and eating properly. I thought that was a great children's time. Thank you, Melissa, for that. We were like connected on the same verse, and I just thought that was like totally cool. I'm like, wow, God, you did it again. You know, you want to take care of yourself. How many of you guys wear Fitbits out there? You wear a Fitbit that helps keep track of your steps each day, keeps you in shape. You set goals. Do I hit 5,000 steps today or 10,000 steps? It keeps you motivated, right? We have all sorts of ideas or good intentions sometimes of a healthy heart, of exercising. But sometimes our diet and exercise isn't as proper, and maybe we're not as healthy as we should be. And sometimes our heart isn't as well as we think it is, and we don't even have any clue about it. Today I want to introduce you to a person that you may or may not know. So Levi, come on up. His name is Levi Peruso. And I just have a few questions to ask Levi today. He's going to tell us a little bit about his story in life. And if you know Levi, you know he has a story. And if you don't know Levi, you're going to know his story when you leave here today. Welcome, Levi. Have a seat.
Okay, I will.
I appreciate you coming in as we're talking about the heart. And first of all, just give us a little bit of details about who you are.
Okay, I am a senior at Johnstown Christian School. My name is Levi Peruso. I have a congenital heart defect. I was diagnosed with it whenever I was born, and they didn't really know that I had it yet until later on, and then I had an open heart surgery whenever I was 4, and lots of things happened. They had to reroute some arteries from the right side to the left side because I wasn't getting enough oxygenated blood into my body. And so lots of praying and fasting, and then I'm here now, 18 years.
Wow. Wow, that's pretty amazing. So does your heart beat differently than anybody else's?
A little bit, because of the, it has a bit of a murmur, and it has to work harder. So, like, it pumps twice the amount of blood through my heart, and so it goes a little faster than other people's.
So are you able to lead a normal life? Are you able to play sports?
Yeah, I can lead a pretty normal life. Whenever I do play sports, and I play soccer and other things like that, it does take me a little longer. I have to slow down a bit, and I get out of breath easier. But I still love doing sports, and I love being active.
Wow. So, Levi, you said you had surgery already. Are there any surgeries in the future for you?
Hopefully not. I do go in for yearly checkup at Children's Hospital, and I'm scheduled for a catheterization to go in and check that my heart is all good. And since I've grown a lot, check if they need to put any stents that would help my blood flow better. But other than that, no.
Have you ever had a heart cath before?
Yes, yeah. I have. Couple years ago, and whenever I was young, whenever I first had my heart surgery.
I remember when you were still in your mother's womb, and that was around 1998. Right? You were born
in
98?
I was born in 1998.
And Diana and I were newlyweds. We're still newlyweds. But we were newlyweds. And I remember a couple that was very special in our lives was your mom and dad, Russ and Jill. And I remember getting the news that this child they were carrying might not be normal. And man, we just spent a lot of time praying and just a lot of time lifting this baby up. And your mom and dad made the choice not to abort.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the doctors said I'd have a lot of problems, that my life would pretty much be like a vegetable. I would just like be alive, but I wouldn't really be there. And so they told my mom and dad that they gave them the option to abort me. And so my mom and dad, after praying and asking a bunch of people to pray, decided to keep me. And so I'm here because they made a decision to keep whatever God had planned for my life. So, yeah.
Wow, that's an amazing story. So Levi, how do you handle life? I mean, this is how God made you. You were not, this is not a result of an injury from sports or something that you overexerted your heart. You've been given this, so how do you deal with that?
I try my best to be, I guess, what you call normal. I do everything with my friends that I can do and be social, and I really take every day that I get as a chance. As Benjamin Franklin said, one today equals two tomorrows. Or no, two today's equal one tomorrow, that's what it was. And so I always try to live my life to the fullest, to whatever God has me planned to do.
So do you ever wish, you're what, the middle child?
Yeah.
Do you ever wish that, like, God would have given this heart to your older brother or younger sister? That you wouldn't have to deal with this?
Maybe.
Sure. You know, those days when they're, like, really getting on your nerves and, you know, you're thinking, ah.
Yeah, sometimes, playing sports, sometimes I'll get angry that I can't catch up, can't push the hardest that I can, but I just can't keep up with some of the other kids. But I really just try and take it as an experience to help and share my story with other people so they can see how God has changed and worked through my life.
Wow. So, what is the next chapter of your life?
Right now I'm planning on go to UPJ for biology, and then moving in, hopefully going to Pitt Maine Medical for pediatrics.
Wow. So through all of this, Levi, you were given something that you really had no choice. How has this shaped your life? How's this made you better?
It's really given me a love for kids, because I would go to children's hospital almost every year, and sometimes even more than once a year. And so you would see kids in worse condition than you are in, and you would just, and they would be so happy. They'd be so full of life and so ready to take on the next challenge. And so that has pushed me and motivated me to help those kids, and that I can relate to what they're going through with my heart condition. And so that's why I want to go into the medical field and work with children, because that's what God has put on my heart.
Wow. Levi, thank you so much for coming here and just sharing part of your story. I so appreciate it. And thank you.
Thanks for inviting me.
We all have a story, and I think it's amazing how God can work even the challenging parts in our life for His good. And that's just a living proof of when God creates something, we need to just let Him take the reins of it. And so that's pretty awesome. Well, today I want to quickly go through what a healthy heart is. Time is quickly passing by, and there are so many scriptures in God's Word about a healthy heart that I could come up here today and I could give you probably 12 to 15 different steps of a healthy heart spiritually, because that's what we want to look at, is our spiritual heart. But today I just want to give you three. I want to give you three, and I want to read these verses again that Harlan read earlier, but I want to read them out of the Message. Okay? So you can follow behind me, or you can follow in your Bible if you have a Message version. It says, "Dear friends, listen well to my words. Tune your ears to my voice. Keep my message in plain view at all times. Concentrate. Learn it by heart. Those who discover these words live, really live, body and soul, they're bursting with health. Keep vigilant watch over your heart. Guard your heart, folks. Why? Because that's where life starts. Don't talk out of both sides of your mouth. Avoid careless banter, white lies, and gossip. Keep your eyes straight ahead. Ignore all sideshow distractions. Watch your step, and the road will stretch out smooth before you. Look neither right nor left. Let evil in the dust." When I read those verses, I find so many things in there of how we can have a healthy heart and what we need to do to have a healthy heart. And the whole thing with a healthy heart is it doesn't just start with the heart. It involves all your other being. These verses tell us about our eyes to watch. They tell us about our mouth, what comes out, about our feet, where we're going. So today, I want to give you three traits of a healthy heart. And I came up with the word, you know me and my acronyms, okay? I came up with the word CPR. Because when your physical heart is in dire need and stops, you give a life-saving technique called CPR. Some of you have learned CPR. Some of you know how to do CPR. So I think a healthy heart requires three things among many others. But the three to concentrate on are CPR. The first thing of a healthy heart is a cheerful heart. Folks, how many of you walk around with a cheerful heart? How many of you walk around with a gloomy heart? A cheerful heart does a lot. You see, there's so much negativity, so much hurt, so much destruction in this world that why wouldn't we be cheerful? Why wouldn't we try to make a difference? And what good that difference might do in somebody's life. No more racking. Racking is a random act of kindness. It should be every day that we're doing kindness towards others. You see, if Christ has changed your heart, then your heart should be beating differently. Proverbs 17:22 says, a cheerful heart is good medicine. And we usually stop there at that verse. But it goes on to say, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. Do you have a crushed spirit today? I don't know, do I? Would you walk around in gloom and doom? That's a crushed spirit. It dries up the bones. It sucks the life right out of you. Have a cheerful heart. And you know what I've found? It is a choice. A cheerful heart is a choice. And it's a choice that I try to make daily. Do I succeed at it every day? No. But I try to do it daily. And you know, I've started a habit of wherever I go, I want to try to make an influence on somebody. And there are some times that I literally, when I walk into a building and there's some buildings that I target that I know that there's not much cheerfulness in there. When I open that door, I take a deep breath and I say, okay, God, use me. Just the other day, I went into a place on Friday, and I walked in there, and usually when I walk in, I say, hey, happy Monday, or happy Tuesday, or whatever day it is. And I walked in on Friday, and the staff looked at me, and they said, happy Friday. And I said, yes, it is. It's Friday. I said, do you know what the best thing about Friday is? And oh, they all smiled. Yeah, there's lots of things. What's the best thing about Friday, Keith? I said, in two more days, it's Monday. That's the best thing about Friday. And they looked at me like I was a lunatic. But you know what? I made them laugh, and I made them think about life a little bit. A cheerful heart is so much better than gloom and doom. And Jesus warns us about the gloom and doom. Jesus tells us his own words in Matthew 15, verses 17 and 18. He says, don't you see that whatever enters the mouth goes into the stomach and then out of the body? But the things that come out of the mouth come from where? The heart. The things that come out of the mouth come from the heart. So think about that, folks. All the words that you say, think about that. That is who we really are, the person you really are. The verses today, I love how it says about guarding our heart, and it says about do not gossip, avoid telling white lies, watch that gossip talk. Yes, I said the G word today, folks. The spreading of gossip. So you see, the only thing we should be spreading is the good news of Jesus Christ, not gossip, because gossip is not healthy. It's not healthy for our heart, and it's not healthy talk, but the good news is healthy. So a healthy heart is a cheerful heart. Another sign of a healthy heart is a protective heart. He tells us here to guard our heart, to protect our heart, you know, because everything flows from it. I find it interesting that we make sure our cars are locked, our houses are locked, deadbolted, security systems. We have firewalls on our computer. We have antiviruses, the works, to protect everything around us. But we fail to protect our heart. We let our guard down when it comes to that. A protective heart is a healthy heart. What do I mean by a protective heart? Well, in Luke 11, 34, it says this: "Your eye is the lamp of your body. When your eyes are good, your whole body also is full of light. But when they are bad, your whole body is full of darkness." What are your eyes looking at? What are you glancing at? What are you wondering at? What are those quick looks about? What are your ears hearing? What's your mouth saying? Sometimes we say a lot of words a day. Watch what you see, watch what you hear, and watch what you say. Guard your heart. Be in God's word. Pray daily. Listen for his voice. And be careful who you hang out with, because that's ultimately who's going to influence you and who you're going to turn out to be. So a healthy heart is also a protective heart. The third thing of a healthy heart is a ready heart. A ready heart. These verses tell us we're on the move. Keep your eyes straight. Stay focused at whatever you do. Don't get sidetracked with all the distractions. Watch your step. You see, a healthy heart is a ready heart. Ready for what? What are we ready for? Well, ready to serve. You see, that's what the Be Mine is all about. When Jesus said to be mine, he wants the ownership of your heart. He wants you to surrender your life to him. And when you stay focused and you surrender your will over to him, when you stay focused, your heart's going to begin beating differently, I'm telling you. And when it begins beating differently, it's going to start beating in sync with God. And when you stay focused and you stay fixed on what God wants you to be doing, you're going to begin to see the surroundings around you in a whole different light. You're going to begin to see situations that you're placed in, and you're going to begin to see opportunities of people who need to see a light. You see, when you have that strong desire in you, and you're going to see this opportunity, you're not going to just look at people as problems. You're going to look at people as those who God created and who he loves. And you're going to want to get involved in them. And you're going to want to be so passionate about people that you're going to want to make disciples. And that's what we are commanded to do. Jesus tells us to go and make disciples. A disciple is a follower, right? A follower. Our goal is to go out there, find those who don't know Jesus, instill our love in them so they can see them and become followers, become disciples of Jesus. And they in turn will be passionate about following Jesus as well. And you know the great thing about sharing? Sometimes we don't even have to use words. You see, sometimes our actions will speak so much louder. Just showing someone you care, showing someone that you're going to listen to them, encouraging someone, helping someone, those are so many different areas that we can help out without even saying a word. A healthy heart is one that's going to flow from you to others. A healthy heart is one that is beating in sync with Christ. Maybe your heart is in need of a little CPR today. And one of those three areas maybe you really need to work on. Maybe it's cheerfulness. Maybe you're just not cheerful. Maybe you realize that I need to work on that. Maybe it's the protective end of it. Maybe there are things that, man, I've really let my guard down and I've let some things come in that have really damaged my heart, and I know they shouldn't be there. And maybe you need to have the ready heart. Yeah, I need to go out and share. I need to go out and share this good news. I can't keep it all to myself. I want to close today with some verses out of Colossians chapter 3. If you have your Bibles, turn there to Colossians chapter 3, starting with verse 15. I'm going to read it out of the Message, so Listen up to these words. It says, let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. None of this going off and doing your own thing. And cultivate thankfulness. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house. Imagine that. Let the word of Christ, the message, have the run of the house, have the run of your heart. Give it plenty of room in your lives, not just something you brush under the rug. Instruct and direct one another using common sense, and sing your hearts out to God. Sing your heart out to God. Praise God for what He has done in your life. Let every detail in your lives, your words, your actions, whatever, be done in the name of the Master Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way. Do you ever think about that in your life? That what you're doing today matters? For who? For Jesus. That every detail of my life should be in honor of Him, and should be, every step should be for Him. So tomorrow when you wake up, yeah, it's Monday. If you want me to call you and tell you happy Monday, I will gladly do that to get you motivated. But tomorrow when you get up, remember, a healthy heart, there needs to be some cheerfulness in there, okay? So maybe you're a little bit cheerful after the second cup of coffee. And if that still doesn't do it, then maybe you need a third. But maybe you need a little bit of Jesus in there too. Maybe you're the protective part of it is what you're really lacking. And you know you need to make some corrections there. Maybe you need to have that ready heart because you know that you need to be sharing to that someone that you're in contact with every day. And you're not even sure that they know that you have Jesus in your heart. Maybe your actions need to change. And so, my prayer and challenge for you this week is to be Christ's ambassadors everywhere you go. Whether it's at work, whether it's driving in the car, whether it's shopping at Walmart. Be Christ's ambassadors. And I just pray that your heart is going to have a different beat this week, one that is in sync with Jesus. Let's pray. Father, you have created us so fearfully and wonderfully, and sometimes it is scary to think how you've created us, God. But you love us so much that you died for each and every one of us, and you gave us each a heart. Father, I thank you for each one of us and for the gifts that you have given us. Father, forgive us for the times that we are not cheerful. Forgive us for the times that we have let our guard down and we aren't protecting our heart. We're not building up our heart. We're not exercising it properly in your word. And forgive us for the times when we're just not ready, when we miss the opportunities, the people that you place in front of us. Father, I just pray that as we leave here today that we can begin to work on our hearts and realize that how we live, how we react, and how we act to situations is truly a reflection of what is really deep down inside of us. Father, this month may we just really work on our hearts and tug on us, help us to clean out those areas that we really need to clean out. Help us not to quit just brushing stuff under the rug, but to really start dealing with things, God. And through it all, we just want to bring you the honor and the glory. In your name I pray. Amen.